Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Vikas Jain from B.S. Anangpuria Institute of Pharmacy, Faridabad. Today, we are going to discuss about a module on emulsion part 1 under paper product development. The learning objectives of current module includes a basic understanding of importance of emulsions as pharmaceuticals, various types of emulsions including microemulsion, multiple emulsion and nanoemulsion, theoretical consideration and development of emulsion that involves discussion on mechanism of working of surfactants and auxiliary emulsifiers, formulation consideration of emulsion that includes selection of lipids and emulsifiers, the HLB concept and its shortcomings and so forth. A precise definition of term emulsion depends on observer's point of view. The physical chemist defines an emulsion as a thermodynamically unstable mixture of two essentially immiscible liquids. For the product development technologist, it is more useful to regard an emulsion as an intimate mixture of two immiscible liquids that exhibits an acceptable self-life near room temperature. When two immiscible liquids are mechanically agitated, both phases initially tend to form droplets. When the agitation is stopped, the droplets quickly coalesce and the two liquids separate. The lifetime of the droplets is materially increased if an emulsifier is added to the two immiscible liquids. Usually, one phase persists in droplet form for a prolonged period of time. This phase is called internal or dispersed or discontinuous phase, and the surrounding by an external, that is known as continuous phase. An assembly of close packed monodispersed spherical droplets as the internal phase can occupy no more than approximately 74% of total volume of an emulsion. An emulsifier is operationally defined as a stabilizer of the droplet form, that is globules, of the internal phase. On the basis of their structure, emulsifiers, that is wetting agents or surfactants, may be described as molecules comprising both hydrophilic and hydrophobic portions. For this reason, the group of compound is frequently called amphiphilic, that is water and oil loving. Emulsions are normally formed by mixing two immiscible liquids. If necessary, the two phases are heated to ensure that they are liquids during emulsifications. The most common types of pharmaceutical or cosmetic emulsion include water as one of diphases and an oil or lipid as the other. If the oil droplets are dispersed in a continuous aqueous phase, the emulsion is termed oil in water. If the oil is continuous phase, the emulsion is termed water in oil type. It has been observed that oil in water emulsions occasionally change into water and oil emulsion and vice versa. This change of emulsion type is called inversion. The particle size of the dispersed phase determines the appearance of an emulsion. The radius of the emulsified droplet in an opaque, usually white emulsion ranges from 0.25 to 10 microns. It is fairly well established that dispersed particles having a diameter of less than the wavelength of visible light, that is less than approximately 120 nanometers, do not refract light and therefore appear transparent to the eye. Dispersions of a liquid to such small particle sizes yield microemulsions or micellar emulsions. Often, these terms are erroneously used interchangeably because such emulsions appear transparent to the human eye in daylight. In a microemulsion, dispersed globule having a radius below the range of 10 to 75 nanometer are generally present. The production of transparent emulsion or dispersion of an oil by micellization does not result in the formation of droplets, but the inclusion of the lipid into micelles, which may need not possess spherical shape. In terms of size, micelles have dimensions ranging from 5 to 20 nanometer. To the practicing technologist, transparent emulsion, solubilized oils, micellar emulsions, and microemulsions are one and the same because they appear clear. However, solubilization in any form represents an entirely different phenomena that different from emulsification. Today, emulsions continue to have a variety of cosmetic and pharmaceutical applications. The latter may be further classified by route of administration, that is topical, oral, or parenteral. In principle, cosmetic applications and topical pharmaceutical applications are similar and together form one of the most important group of emulsion. Patient compliance undoubtedly is the most important reason why emulsion are popular oral and topical doses form. Many medicinal agents have an objectionable taste or texture and can be made more palatable for oral administration when formulated into an emulsion. Unabsorbable macromolecules such as insulin and heparin are absorbed when they are incorporated into emulsions. Oil and water emulsions are most useful as water washable drug bases and for general cosmetic purposes. Water and oil emulsions are employed more widely for the treatment of dry skin and emollient applications. It is also used for intravenous administration of lipid nutrient. Radio-opaque emulsions used as diagnostic agents in X-ray examinations. Water in oil emulsions have been employed to disperse water-soluble antigenic materials in mineral oil for intramuscular depot injection. Emulsified perfluorinated hydrocarbons is used as oxygen carriers in blood replacements. When oil and water are mixed and agitated, droplets of varying size are produced. A tension exists at the dye interface because the two immiscible phases tend to have different attractive forces for a molecule at the interface. A molecule of phase A is attracted into phase A and repelled by phase B. In general, the greater the degree of immiscibility, the greater is the interfacial tension. The interfacial tension at a liquid interface is defined as the work required to create 1 cm square of new interface. A fine dispersion of oil and water necessitates a large area of interfacial contact, and its production requires an amount of work equal to the product of interfacial tension and the area change. Thermodynamically speaking, this work is the interfacial free energy imparted to the system. A high interfacial free energy favors a reduction of interfacial area, first by causing droplets to assume a spherical shape and then by causing them to coalesce. This is the reason for including the word thermodynamically unstable in the classic definition of opaque emulsions. We'll now discuss droplet stabilization. Two conceptual alternatives exist for creating opaque emulsions. First is by lowering the interfacial tension and by preventing dicoalescence of droplets. Both the objectives can be achieved by using emulsifying agents that may comprise of the combination of one or more surface active agents, hydrophilic colloids, and finely divided solids. Emulsifying agents generally assist in the formation of emulsions by three mechanisms. The first mechanism is a reduction of interfacial tension, that is thermodynamic stabilization. Second one is interfacial film formation, that is mechanical barrier to coalescence. And third one is electrical repulsion, that is electrical barrier to approach of particles. How reduction of interfacial tension helps in stabilizing an emulsion? That we'll discuss over here. The adsorption of a surfactant lowers the interfacial tension between two liquids. A reduction in attractive forces of dispersed liquid for its own molecules lowers the interfacial free energy of the system and prevents the coalescence or phase separation. Even though reduction of interfacial tension lowers the interfacial free energy produced on dispersion, many polymers and finely divided solids not efficient in reducing interfacial tension, but generates an excellent interfacial barrier because they get absorbed on the interface. We will now discuss interfacial film formation with the help of surface active agent. The first kind is monomolecular film formation. An amphiphilic molecule aligns itself at a water-oil interface in most energetically favorable position. Oleophilic portion of the surfactant lies in oil phase, while hydrophilic portion lies in the aqueous phase. Surface active agents tend to concentrate at interfaces. Emulsifiers are adsorbed at oil-water interfaces as monomolecular film. These monomolecular films formed at the interface depends upon the nature, characteristics, concentration, and combination of surfactants. We will now discuss various types of films that are generated under interfacial film formation. The first one is gaseous film. The adsorbed surfactant molecules do not adhere to each other and keeps on floating. That generates a gaseous film. Condensed film. At high concentration of surfactant, a rigid film is generated. Expanded films. The polar bulky groups of surfactants causes steric hindrance and prevent coalescence of droplets. Interfacial complex condensed films results from combination of a water-soluble surfactant that produces a gaseous film and an oil-soluble surfactant produce a stable interfacial complex condensed film. And the last concept is of lamellar liquid crystalline films. Stable emulsions are now believed to comprise of liquid crystalline layers on the interface of emulsified droplets with the continuous phase. Emulsions should instead be viewed as three-component systems comprising of oil, water, and lamellar liquid crystal, the latter consisting of consecutive layers of water, emulsifier, oil, and water. We will now discuss the behavior of hydrophilic colloids that generates multimolecular film formation. Hydrophilic colloids such as polysaccharides and proteins do not lower appreciably the interfacial tension, but form a multimolecular film at the oil-water interface. The molecular films are strong and elastic and give mechanical protection to coalescence. An additional effect of these hydrophilic colloids is the electrostatic charge repulsion due to carboxylic acid groups of polysaccharides and amino acid groups of the proteins. Hydrophilic colloids are used to stabilize emulsion and form oil in water type emulsions. Finely divided solids, when exposed to interface, generates a solid particle film at the interface. Finely divided solid particles are lodged at the interface, adhere strongly to each other, forming a stable film at the surface. They formed stable emulsions by preferentially wetting one of the phases. When wetted by water, the contact angle is less than 90 degrees, and oil and water type emulsions are generated. While wetted by oil, a water in oil type emulsion is generated. We'll now discuss electrical repulsion. Interfacial films or similar film can produce repulsive electrical forces between approaching droplets. Such repulsion is due to an electrical double layer, which may arise from electrically charged groups oriented on the surface of emulsified globules. The potential produced by the double layer creates a repulsive effect between the oil droplets and thus hinders coalescence. Repulsive electrical potential cannot be measured directly. However, zeta potential can be determined. The zeta potential for a surfactant stabilized emulsion compares favorably with the calculated double layer potential. Emulsion can be classified as simple emulsion, multiple emulsions, micro emulsions, and nano emulsions. Out of simple emulsions, two categories exist, that is oil in water type and water in oil type. Multiple emulsions to follow the same pattern, but it comprises of three phases. First thing is water in oil in water type, and the second category is oil in water in oil type. We will now discuss how emulsion types are elucidated to understand various factors that determine whether an oil in water or water in oil emulsion will be produced. One must again think in terms of two critical features. First one is droplet formation, and second one is formation of an interfacial barrier. The phase volume ratio, that is the relative amount of oil in water, determines the relative number of droplets formed initially and hence the probability of collision. The greater the number of droplets, the greater is the chances of collision. To predict the type of emulsion, few generalized and empiric rules can be given. First one is amphiphile is essentially water soluble, that favors oil in water type of emulsification. Surfactant is primarily soluble in lipid portion, favor water in oil type emulsion. The polar portion of emulsifiers are better barriers to coalescence, hence it is possible to make oil in water emulsion with relatively high internal phase volumes. Water in oil emulsions can invert easily if the amount of water present is significant. At 20 to 30% water content, water in oil emulsion form only if the water is added to the oil with mixing. The addition of both phases together followed by mixing favors oil in water type emulsion at concentration above 10% of water. The type of emulsion formed is influenced by the viscosity of each phase. An increase in the viscosity of a phase aids in making this phase the external phase. Despite these complications, one can expect a predominantly water-soluble emulsifier to form an oil-in-water emulsions, whereas reverse is true of primarily oil-soluble surfactants. This particular rule is known as Bancroft's rule. In order to determine various type of emulsion, different tests have been designed. First test is dilution test. In this test, emulsions can be diluted only with external phase, and this test is useful for liquid emulsions only. Second test is dye test, in which water-soluble dyes tints only oil-in-water type emulsions. This particular test may fail if ionic emulsifiers are present. Third test is cobalt chloride impregnated filter paper. In this test, filter paper impregnated with cobalt chloride and dried, that is blue in color, changes to pink color when it has been exposed to oil in water emulsion. This test may also fail if emulsion is unstable or breaks in presence of electrolyte. Next test is identification of fluorescence. Since oil fluoresces under UV light, oil in water emulsions exhibit dot pattern, while water in oil emulsions fluoresces throughout. This test is not always applicable. And the last test is conductivity. In this test, electric current is conducted by oil in water type emulsion owing to presence of ionic species in water. This particular test fails in non-ionic oil in water type of emulsions. We will now discuss what are microemulsions. Operationally, microemulsions may be defined as dispersions of insoluble liquids in a second liquid that appear clear and homogeneous to the naked eyes. Microemulsions are frequently called solubilized systems because on a macroscopic basis, they seem to behave as true solutions. Careful examinations of these complex systems has shown that clear emulsions can exist in several differentiable forms. Microemulsions should not be confused, however, with solutions formed by co-solvency. For example, the clear system consisting of water, benzene, and ethanol. These are believed to be thermodynamically stable. The microemulsions can be of three types. First one is oil and water micellar solution. Second one is reverse micellar solution. And third type of microemulsion is usually of water in oil type. We'll now focus on multiple emulsions or double emulsions. In this type of emulsions, internal phase itself contains a dispersed phase globules. The central phase acts as a membrane that allows interface transfer of solutes. The types that we already discussed are water in oil in water type and oil in water in oil type. These type of systems can be prepared either by double emulsification or through phase inversion. Primary emulsion in case of double emulsification is emulsified in an external phase to produce a multiple emulsion. While in case of phase inversion of oil in water emulsion forms oil in water in oil emulsion, and that of water in oil emulsion after phase inversion will generate water in oil in water type of emulsion. We'll now discuss nano emulsion. These are extremely small droplet emulsions. It is so small that the interaction of matter with light is negligible and they appear transparent or translucent with bluish coloration. Nano emulsions is actually a misnomer because the drop size is around 100 nanometer and broadly speaking in 50 to 500 nanometer range. Globule size of microemulsions is actually smaller than that of nanoemulsions. Emulsions with small droplets in the range of 50 nanometer to 1 micron should be called mini emulsions, but the term nanoemulsions has prevailed. Nanoemulsions or mini emulsions are true emulsions with dispersed phase droplets and continuous phase and a surface area, which is much smaller than microemulsions, thus requiring much less amount of surfactants. Two type of preparative techniques are available for generating nanoemulsions, and both of them are called phase transition methods, in which destabilizing the microemulsion structure to produce a nanoemulsion is brought, and second one is catastrophic inversion, in which emulsion containing drops of oil in water type suddenly becomes dispersion of water in oil and vice versa. While focusing on development of formulation component, it is difficult to designate a general approach or set of rules for selecting the components and their amounts to yield a desired emulsion. The ingredients of any pharmaceutical or cosmetic emulsion must conform to various requirements. There are situations in which certain oils, emulsifiers, and other ingredients must be avoided or used exclusively. Usually, however, ingredient selection is made on the basis of the experience and personal tastes of the formulator and by trial and error too. Formulators are cautioned to establish the safety and regulatory acceptance of emulsion ingredients for a particular application. We'll now discuss lipid phases under formulation components. There are different classes of lipid phases, that is hydrocarbons, esters, alcohols, fatty acids, ethers, and silicones. We will discuss one by one. First agent under hydrocarbon class is mineral oil. Its consistency is fluid with different grades of viscosity. Second agent is petrolatum. It is semi-solid. Next agent is polyethylene waxes. that is solid. Microcrystalline vexes, these are also solids. Under ester category, vegetable oils are fluids. Animal fats are fluids or solids. Lanolin, it's semi-solid. And synthetics, that is isopropyl myristate, is a fluid. Under alcohols, long chain natural and synthetic alcohols are available that are either fluids or solids. Under fatty acids, long chain natural and synthetic fatty acids with fluid grade and solid grades are available. Under category ethers, polyoxypropylenes, fluids of varying viscosity is available. And the last category, it is silicones. These are actually substituted silicones, and these are also supplied as fluids of varying viscosity. Lipid phase is an essential component of the emulsion system. A drug distributes in accordance between water and oil with its oil and water partition coefficient. The drug's absorption depends on its solubility in the oil phase. The solubility of the drug in vehicle is necessary to ensure its presence in small size. The parameter that determines the amount of lipid present in a system is phase ratio. It is the ratio of internal phase to external phase. It is determined by the solubility of the active ingredients. Phase ratio is determined by the desired characteristics. Fluid emulsions results from low levels of internal phase, while heavier emulsions are the results of high level of internal phase. So the viscosity is determined with the amount of internal phase present. Another component of emulsion is emulsifying agents or surface active agents or surfactants. A representative structure of surface active agent is given here that comprises of a hydrophilic region, that is head, and a hydrophobic region, that is a tail. Substance having both hydrophilic and hydrophobic regions in their molecular structures are surfactant. It is soluble in both water and oil. It diffuses from solutions onto the interface. Interfacial tension must be lowered for the interface to expand. The number of surfactants available for the formation of emulsion is so huge that even a cursory description is impossible. Surfactants are classified into four main categories depending on the nature of the charge carried by the hydrophilic part of the surfactant. Anionic surfactants are negatively charged in aqueous solution and widely used because of their cost and performance. Sodium lauryl sulfate, the main component of which is sodium dodecyl sulfate, is highly soluble in water and commonly used to form oil and water type of emulsions. Cationic surfactants are positively charged in an aqueous solution and considered expensive because of their bactericidal action. They are widely used for other applications such as preservatives, sterilizing contaminated surfaces, and emulsions. Nonionic surfactants consist of oxyethylene or hydroxyl as the hydrophilic group and exhibit a variety of hydrophile lipophile balance, that is known as HLB, which stabilize OYW or WYO emulsions. Nonionic surfactants are useful for oral and parenteral formulations because of their low irritation and toxicity. Based on their neutral nature, they are much less sensitive to change in the pH of the medium and the presence of electrolytes. The best use of nonionic surfactant is to produce an equally balanced HLB of two nonionic surfactants, one hydrophilic and another one hydrophobic. Next category is amphipolytic surfactants that possess both cationic and anionic groups in the same molecule and are dependent on the pH of the medium. Lecithin is used for parenteral emulsions. We will now discuss classification of surfactants for pharmaceutical emulsions. Surfactants are classified as major categories as anionic surfactants and ampholytic surfactants. Under anionic surfactants, the various categories are soap, with typical representative as sodium oleate, sulfates as sodium lauryl sulfate, ether sulfates as sodium laureth sulfate, benzene sulfonates as 4-benzyl dodecan sulfonate sodium, hemiesters as sodium dioctyl sulfosuccinate, sarcosides as lauryl sarcosinate. Under category of cationic surfactants, first agent is amines and its example is tetradecyl methyl amine. Quaternary ammoniums, example is benzyl conium chloride, hexadecyl trimethyl ammonium chloride, cetrimide. And miscellaneous category comprises of cetyl pyridinium chloride. Under category non-ionic surfactants, ethoxylated alcohols can be exemplified with the help of tridecanol, ethoxylated amide, its example is diacyl ethoxyurea, fatty acid esters may comprise of sorbitan monostearate or SPAN 60, polyoxyethylene sorbitan monolaurate, that is polysorbit 20 or twin 20, and glycerol trimer. Under category ampholytic surfactants, ammonium phosphates are there. Its representative example is lecithin, and quaternary ammonium compounds that can be exemplified with betaine or sulfobetaine. We will now discuss hydrophilic lipophilic balance, that is HLB concept. Emulsion technologists have for many years selected emulsifiers from an intuitive knowledge of their hydrophilic lipophilic behavior and of the type of emulsions produced with a given lipid or aqueous phase. This approach is most readily illustrated with non-ionic surfactants, but the principles involved can be extrapolated to any type of emulsifier or combination of emulsifiers. It is apparent that the choice of specific emulsifiers by this method, although practical, is empiric and tedious. To systemize the hydrophilic lipophilic approach to emulsifier selection, Griffin in 1947 developed the system of HLB of surfactants. The HLB value of an emulsifier can be determined experimentally or can be computed as long as the structural formula of the surfactant is known. Another useful means of finding the HLB of an unknown emulsifier is that proposed by Davies, which permits calculation of the HLB value by algebraically adding the values assigned to a particular atomic grouping within the molecules of emulsifier. So, HLB of surfactant is equals to summation of hydrophilic group minus summation of hydrophobic group plus 7, where the HLB of the mixture of surfactants A with value HLB A and of surfactant B with HLB value of HLB B is calculated by a formula that is equals to FA multiplied by HLB of surfactant A plus 1 minus FA multiplied by HLB value of surfactant B. In this equation, FA is the weight fraction of surfactant A in the mixture. In general, molecules that are oil soluble or oil dispersible have low HLB values. Those that are water soluble have high HLB values. We will now discuss application of surfactants based on their HLB values. Surfactants with HLB values in the range of 1 to 3 acts as anti-foaming agents. Surfactants with HLV value 3 to 6 acts as water in oil emulsifying agents. Surfactants with HLV value 7 to 9 acts as wetting agents. HLV value of 8 to 16 bearing surfactants generates oil in water emulsifying agent. The surfactants with HLV value 13 to 15 are detergents, and in the range of 15 to 18 are solubilizing agents. The HLV required for emulsifying particular oil in water can be determined by trial and error, that is, by preparing appropriate emulsions with emulsifiers having a range of HLV values and then determining that HLV value that yields the best emulsion. Although the numbers have been derived empirically, they are useful starting points for the preparation of a variety of emulsion. A list of required HLV values for lipids that are of interest in pharmaceutical preparation is shown in this slide. The knowledge of required HLV permits selection of an emulsifier or a combination of emulsifier that will produce the required HLV. So, the HLV values required by commonly used lipids is as given. The first component is cetyl alcohol, and for preparing oil in water emulsion, it requires an HLV value of 15. For sterile alcohol, it is 14. For stearic acid, it is 15. For lanolin anhydrous, for preparing oil in water emulsion, required HLV is 10. And for water in oil emulsion, the HLV value is 8. Mineral oil, light and heavy, requires an HLV value of 12 for preparing oil in water type emulsion. Cottonseed oil requires HLV value of 10 for oil in water and value of 5 for water in oil. With petrolatum, for oil in water, HLV is 12, and for water in oil type emulsion, required HLV is 5. With beeswax, the required HLV for oil in water emulsion is 12, and for water in oil emulsion, it is 4. For paraffin wax, the required HLV for preparing oil in water emulsion is 11, and for water in oil emulsion, it is 4. There are various shortcomings that are associated with HLV system too. Emulsion specialists generally agree that the HLV system is useful and that it may be used judiciously and with caution. It is a dictum of HLV concept that the HLV value is critical, but this is not always the case. There is no assurance that a stable emulsion prepared from one chemical class of emulsifiers at a particular HLV can be duplicated by another class of emulsifiers exhibiting the same HLV. Additional complications arise from the observations that the HLV required for a particular emulsion to some extent depends on the phase ratio and the salt content. Several improvements on the classical HLV system for the selection of emulsifiers have been proposed. The phenol index developed by Marshall makes it possible to determine the effective HLV of 99X as a function of their concentration and in the presence of additives such as alcohols and glycols. Griffin originally proposed that emulsifier with HLV values ranging from 3.5 to 6 should be used for water in oil type of emulsion. But Ford and Firmage suggested that correlation between emulsion type and HLV is far from perfect. HLV may be one consideration in the preparation of a stable emulsion. Another is the solubility of emulsifier's lipid chain in the oil phase. Most of our knowledge of the selection of emulsifiers is based on the HLV concept and is applied to the commonly used non-ionic surfactants. A somewhat different interpretation of emulsifying efficacy of phospholipid, which does not involve HLV, was offered by Redek. She reported that best soybean oil in water emulsion can be obtained with mixed phospholipids containing the largest amount of negatively charged phospholipids. Now, we'll discuss how surfactant amount is to be determined. This discussion of the selection of emulsifier would be incomplete without a brief examination of how one can determine that surfactant mixture of which the least amount is required for optimal stability of an emulsion. Often, this goal can be achieved by determining the amount of water that can be solubilized in a given oil plus surfactant mixture under carefully controlled temperature and stirring conditions. For this purpose, 10 gram of lipid surfactant mixture is weighed into 68 ml capacity of a square glass vial after equilibration at a temperature at which system is fluid, water is added in 0.1 ml increments. The mixture is shaken and allowed to stand at the equilibration temperature until all air bubbles have escaped. The addition of water is continued until the system remains permanently turbid. If the initial lipid surfactant mixture is not clear, it will usually become clear upon addition of water and then become cloudy again upon continued addition. This second cloud point is the end of the titration. As a rule, the most stable oil and water type emulsion with the finest particle size results at the surfactant oil ratio that can tolerate the largest quantity of water and still remains clear. We will now discuss various auxiliary emulsifiers that includes hydrophilic colloids, polymers that are water sensitive, that is swellable or water soluble, have some utility as primary emulsifiers. However, their major use is as auxiliary emulsifiers and as thickening agents too. Natural and synthetic clays of smectite or amphibole group are commonly used for building the viscosity of emulsion or for suspending solids such as pigments in makeup preparations. A large variety of natural and synthetic clays is available, and the selection of useful clay is occasionally difficult. The most commonly used clays, that is bentonites, are derived from montmorillonite, a typical smectite clay. These swell in the presence of water but raise the viscosity of aqueous medium only at a pH 6 or higher. Clays derived from amphibole group such as atapalgite thicken not by swelling but primarily because of particle anisotropy, which interferes with formation of compact sediment. Most natural hydrocolloids or gums exhibit some type of incompatibility with cations or other polymers. Some most useful synthetic hydrocolloids are ethers derived from cellulose. The examples of organic hydrocolloids useful in emulsion technology with their source, their name, and their essential utilities or characteristics are given in this table. The first source is tree exudates, from which we can obtain gum arabic, gum ghatti, gum karaya, and tragacanth. These are essentially neutral polysaccharides. From seaweed source, agar, carrageenan, and alginates are obtained. Agar and carrageenan are sulfated polysaccharides, while alginates are acidic polysaccharides. From seed extracts, we obtain locust bean, guar gum, quince seed. These are essentially neutral polysaccharides. Synthetic source, we obtain xanthan gum. It is also essentially neutral polysaccharides. From cellulose, we obtain methyl, hydroxyethyl, hydroxypropyl ether, carboxymethyl ether. Carboxymethyl ether is anionic, while methyl hydroxyethyl hydroxypropyl ether is neutral polysaccharide. From collagen source, we obtain gelatin, that is an amphoteric protein, and from synthetic source, polyoxyethylene polymers are neutral in origin, while carboxyvinyl polymer, it is cross-linked, it is anionic in nature. Under the category of auxiliary emulsifiers, finely divided solids have been shown to be good emulsifiers, especially in combination with surfactants or macromolecules that increase viscosity. Included are polar inorganic solids such as heavy metal hydroxides, certain non-swelling clays and pigments. Even non-polar solids, for example, carbon or glyceryl tristearate can be used. Polar solids tend to be weighted by water to a greater extent than by the oil phase, whereas the reverse is true for non-polar solids. In the absence of surfactants, water in oil type emulsions are favored by the presence of non-polar solids, presumably because the wetting of oil facilitates the coalescence of oil droplets during initial step of emulsification. An analogous interpretation may be given for tendency of polar solids to favor water as the external phase in the presence of wetting agent, that is when such solids are used as auxiliary emulsifiers, their behavior is controlled by the so-called Young equation. For example, barium sulfate in presence of sodium laureth favors oil in water emulsion, whereas barium sulfate coated with sodium dodecyl sulfate favors water in oil type of emulsion. In view of the limited utility of such solids as primary emulsifiers or even as auxiliary emulsifiers, they are not of major interest to the formulators. Apart from lipids and emulsifying agents, various other formulation adjuvants are required for developing a pharmaceutically elegant emulsion. These agents include the sweeteners, preservatives, color, perfumes, flavors that may materially affect the characteristics of the emulsion system. The antimicrobial preservatives used in the emulsions are selected on the basis of the type of emulsion manufactured, because water is one of the phases often encountered in the emulsions. These must be properly preserved. Care must be exercised in non-selecting preservative that might interact with the surfactants. They may get absorbed onto the packaging material and be lost to a point at which they are rendered inactive. The presence of oil phase also requires inclusion of antioxidants where necessary, and these may be include such agents as gallic acid, propyl gallate, butylated hydroxytoluene, sulfites and so forth. The details in regard to formulation adjuvants were discussed in other modules, hence I will not talk much on excipient section over here. Therefore, from the whole discussion, we can conclude that emulsions are essentially unstable system. Careful selection of lipids and emulsifying agents are to be made while formulating emulsions. The interaction of two immiscible phases should be controlled in such a manner that the chances of coalescence and phase separation are negligible. The mechanism of working of surfactants and auxiliary emulsifiers should be clearly understood. The knowledge we gained from this discussion will really help us to develop emulsion with desired characteristics. A proper selection of mixture of surfactants with desired HLV value will definitely help formulation scientists. Students are suggested to refer standard literature and e-text attached to this module for future reading. Thanks a lot.